Extra, extra, FBI captured Germany. Read all about it, Nazi spygate captured.
We sat in our theaters unbelieving as motion pictures exposed Nazi espionage in America.
As Germans, we know that if America is to be free, we must destroy the chain that ties the whole misery of American politics together. And that chain is the United States Constitution.
Could these things really be? Yes, these subversive acts were happening in real life every day. German-American Bunds, organized for the purpose of destroying us, marched under our very noses.
I pledge undivided allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and the republic for which it stands, one nation, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
In our press, we read the news from abroad that Nazis were spending millions, arming Germany to the teeth. We read that the Tokyo Diet was appropriating tremendous sums, converting Japan into one vast munitions plant. We watched these supposedly poor have-not nations spend huge sums for armament, and we wondered why. Arrogantly, they told us why. They had declared war on us long before the shooting started.
We have actually been at war since the day when we lifted the flag of our revolution against the democratic world.
The Germans are a noble and unique race to whom the earth was given by the grace of God.
The world must come to look up to our emperor as the great ruler of all nations.
When the people of these three nations elected to follow their leaders, Death Incorporated, they organized to smash personal freedom, equality of man, freedom of speech, freedom of religion, organized to smash the very principles which made us the people we are. So in December 1938, when the Gallup poll asked us, should the United States increase the strength of its Army, Navy, and Air Force? We answered yes, 85%. It was time to look to our defense.
Gentlemen, this is the Military Affairs Committee of the United States House of Representatives meeting for the purpose of considering national defense.
The Navy is asking for an increase of 25% in authorized naval tonnage in view of the grave international situation.
Congress, reflecting the voice of the people, appropriated the largest sum for military use ever voted during peace in American history. We didn't dream that a few years later it would look like peanuts. On March 14, 1939, Adolf Hitler broke the pledge he made at Munich. He took over all the rest of Czechoslovakia. There would be no more peace in our time. April 7, 1939, as we here in America observe Good Friday,
Mussolini invades Albania! Extra paper, Italy attacks Albania!
The picture was becoming clear. The conquering forces of violence were being set loose in the world. Where would they stop? In an effort to avert a world war, President Roosevelt, as a neutral, sent messages to Hitler and Mussolini, asking their promise to respect the independence of 30 free countries. To Adolf Hitler, this message was a huge joke, as he repeated the names to a jeering Reichstag.
Sweden, Denmark, Netherlands, Belgium, Großbritannien, Irland, Frankreich, Portugal, Spanien, die Schweiz, Liechtenstein, Luxemburg, Polen, Ungarn, Rumänien, Jugoslawien, Russland, Bulgarien, Türkei, Irak, Arabien, Syrien, Palästina, Ägypten.
This was the only answer the president received. On September the 1st, 1939, the Nazi army smashed into Poland. England and France had a treaty with Poland. Would they act now? At home, we listened in suspense.
Adolf Hitler's all-out attack on Poland makes the long-dreaded European war a certainty. Prime Minister Chamberlain of Great Britain gave the Nazi dictator a 0 hour for withdrawing his troops from Poland. That 0 hour ends now. At this time, we transfer you to London for an important announcement by the British Prime Minister.
Up to the very last, it would have been quite possible to have arranged a peaceful and honorable settlement between Germany and Poland, but Hitler would not have it. For the situation in which no word given by Germany's ruler could be trusted, and no people or country could feel itself safe, had become intolerable. Now may God bless you all, and may he defend the right, for it is evil things that we shall be fighting against. And against them, I am certain that the right will prevail.
6 hours after Great Britain declared war on Nazi Germany, the Republic of France followed. All France is in a maelstrom of activity. The Maginot Line has already opened fire on the Germans. The sparring is ended. World War II has begun.
At home, we were asked, what country do you consider responsible for causing this war? Germany, 82%. We Americans had no doubt who started it. Also, we began to fear that this war was going to concern us. President Roosevelt called a special session of Congress to reconsider the embargo against selling munitions.
I have asked the Congress to reassemble in extraordinary session in order that it may consider and act on changes in our neutrality law.
The men of Congress wrestled with their beliefs and our futures. They debated and they argued.
The arms embargo is far too great a security to American peace to permit its surrender without a last-ditch fight.
The Embargo Act, as it now stands, is one-sided and works entirely to the advantage of one side. Therefore, the Embargo Act should be modified.
We the people also debated and argued whether we should sell arms and munitions. When the question was put to us, we had an answer. Should we change the Neutrality Act so we can sell war supplies? Yes, 57%. Shortly after, our representatives changed the Neutrality Act. We lifted the embargo on arms and munitions. Now we would sell, if purchasers would pay and take the stuff away in their own ships. American ships were still barred from combat zones. Meanwhile, on the other side of the globe, Japan was busy trying to bomb, shoot, and terrorize the Chinese into submission. We began to realize that if Japan conquered 400 million Chinese, she might become so strong as to run us right out of the Pacific. You will remember that 2 years earlier, in September 1937, when we were asked, in the present fight between Japan and China, are your sympathies with either side? Only 43% were with China. Most of us were undecided. In June 1939, when we were asked the same question, 74% said we were with China.